country western night. We've got the cheerleaders dressed up as cowboys. And I did see some horses out there.
Absolutely, and we're about to see some Ravens, hopefully playing well tonight. I was just talking with assistant coach of the Ravens, Rob Smart, talking about that the number one key they consider is that Waterloo cannot beat them as long as they match or best them with respect to rebounding. And the other real key is the containment of that man right there, number nine, Cam McIntyre. If Carleton can contain Cam, then they have a good shot at running away with this one, as long as they take care of the rebounds as well.
The McIntyre, 6'4", he's listed as a guard. Is he a guard or a forward?
Well, the truth is that he's got a good enough game to play both, but you'll see him play a little bit more as a forward.
The Ravens have their usual starting five. Elliot Thompson, Cole Hovind, Philip Scrub, Tyson Hinds, and
and the Carleton starters have been fairly consistent, other than the fact that Kyle Menziak did have an injury a little while ago. They love the fact that they have a great substitution in Willie Maniget coming off the bench to offer energy, which he certainly does. He's been playing well. I have to commend, though, the play of Elliot Thompson of late.
What about Kevin Churchill?
Without a doubt, Kevin Churchill's game has advanced to the point where his significant minutes have been a real good reason why the Ravens have not stumbled despite the loss of Aaron Chapman.
I'm surprised at you by Kevin Churchill and the way he's played this year.
He certainly has developed. His rotation in the post is comfortable for Coach Smart and his staff to put in any situation where he used to not be in that category, in terms of turnovers, in terms of his offensive ability and his defensive liabilities. He really has worked on his game.
Jim's gotten a lot noisier, but Smentiak controls off the scrub. Scrub setting up the Ravens offense, dribbles to the right side of the arc, down center. Passes off to Hinds, takes the three, and two-point basket. Ravens up 2-0.
That'll be a matchup that is tough for Coach Tom Keyswater in his 20th year. Tyson can score from the outside, can score off penetration, and can score off a traditional post-up. There is no way to defend him one-on-one in this league. He needs to be played by a second defender.
Mike Wright hits a three for Waterloo. Waterloo up 1 point, 3-2. We're very early, less than a minute into the ballgame. Hinds off to Scrub. Scrub drives to the basket, makes a layup. 4-3 Ravens. Waterloo coach in his 20th year. That's a long, long time in this league.
Yeah, been to the Nationals a couple times, and a great coach, was a great player, former national team player, and has done a great job with the Waterloo program over the years.
Smenziak off the scrub. Scrub driving to the basket, off balance, makes the basket. Nice little basket there by Philip Scrub.
Well, you know, I don't know the Waterloo team well enough to predict. However, I can tell you that this pace of play, Carleton is absolutely loving.
Well, Carleton brings the pace to you. They try to dictate the pace.
Absolutely, and they have the depth and experience to keep it going. And they just continue, they're relentless. They continue to hammer away from you, and they don't mind if it's a close game for a long time, because they will wear you down over time.
Scrub getting ready for the extra point there. Makes it 7-3 now for the Ravens. Waterloo managed to inbound the ball, misses. Thompson with the rebound, deals off the scrub. Scrub underneath the Hinds with the basket. Again, we talked about Philip Scrub being able to see the basketball court and his ability to pass the ball.
Absolutely. But it requires, I mean, he does have that natural ability, but it requires teammates who space properly to score. They have to want to the ball instead of hiding. And that time, Tyson made himself available beautifully by an inside seal in the post. Yes, Phillip saw him.
Scrub with the ball again. Let's see who he sees this time. And he sees Tyson Hinge, who drives. Tyson with the off balance. Foul on Kyle Smenziak.
Coach Smart lamenting the fact that Tyson chose the penetration when the closeout wasn't really there. There was a lot of room to get that shot away when Tyson originally caught the ball on the wing.
9-3 for the Ravens. 8 minutes left in. We're just 2 minutes into the ball game here. Mike White with the ball for Waterloo. Turns it over. Hoban drives to the basket and never really got a good shot away there.
No, and it was a credit to the defense. They really, with determination, got back and bothered the shot and then followed up with a rebound. Waterloo has come to compete for sure.
Elliot Thompson on the turnover. Thompson now looking. Off the scrub. They're both beyond the three-point arc. Scrub drives to the basket. Puts up the soft jumper. Misses. Gets his own rebound. Misses. Waterloo gets the rebound. Wright drives to the basket. Misses. Out of bounds. Ball goes to Waterloo.
Certainly appears as though it is a Waterloo Warrior game plan based on the support of the coach for this pace. Looking to score early in the shot clock. Willing to run and penetrate very early before setting up any quarter court offense. And it's been fun to watch from a fan's point of view so far.
Right inbounds the ball. To number 9, who you talked about earlier, Ken McIntyre, who missed the jumper. Scrub. Back to Thompson. Back to Scrub. Off to Tyson Hinge. Tyson drives underneath. Traveling on Cole Hoban. Now, there are no good traveling violations. But the Ravens are working hard.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is, as I said, this is the pace of play. If they can keep up this defensive pressure, they will wear down Waterloo through this game.
Waterloo kicks it outside. Air ball. Ball goes out of bounds. Back to the Ravens. Kevin Churchill coming in the ballgame for Kyle Smenziak for the Ravens. Tyson Hinge getting ready to inbound the ball to Phillip Scrub.
Well, I'm certain that we're going to have to see Willie Manigat soon. The pace has been such that Ravens will have to go into the bench a little bit earlier than usual.
Elliot Thompson at the three. Misses. Tyson Hinge gets the rebound. And last year's CIS Athlete of the Year, 11-3 for the Ravens. McIntyre with the shot. Three-point shot misses. Rebound by Tyson Hinge off to Phillip Scrub. Scrub heads up court. Off to Thompson. Back to Hinge. Julian Manigat getting ready to come in. Off to Phillip Scrub. Scrub. Shot clock under 10 seconds. Back to Scrub. Takes the shot. Two-point basket. Misses. Waterloo controls the rebound. Kevin Churchill picks up a turnover, back to Thompson, up to Scrub. Scrub heads up court. At this pace, nobody needs a 24-second clock. But to Thompson for a three-point shot, makes a three-point shot. 14-3 for the Ravens. An absolutely frenetic pace right now.
It really is, although Carleton loving it. Cole Hoban knocking down the three. You know, one of the things that viewers at home should know is if you don't know who the other team's star is, just watch who Cole Hoban starts on. Because defensively, Cole is simply one of the best defenders in the country, bar none. He understands how to defend. Although Cam McIntyre is one of the country's best players, the truth is, I don't envy his task tonight going up against Cole Hoban.
14-3. Waterloo calls an early timeout. Good timeout?
Oh, I think it's absolutely necessary. I mean, who cares if you have timeouts late in the game if you're down 40? You really can't let a game slip away from you this early. And you have to decide, even though it appears as though Waterloo is willing to run, it can't turn into a thing where Carlton's scoring three layups to your one.
That was my question. Does Waterloo, that appears to want to play the up-tempo game with the Ravens, do they not try to slow the pace down?
I don't know that they have the personnel to slow the pace down. I think offensively you say play it natural, go ahead and run. What he's talking about is transition defense.
Once again, the score 14-3 for the Ravens. Howard Bloom with Bill Arden on the Streaming Sports Network. 5:18 left in the first quarter. Ravens beat Waterloo 69-51 in the women's game. Crosstown, I believe it is Ottawa U at the end of the first quarter, 26-21 over Laurier. Waterloo setting up the ball here. Need to get a good shot here. Need to take their time. And they took a three-point shot, but that was a good three-point shot.
We have a call away from the ball, a foul that Coach Smart is not happy about. It appears to be a rebounding foul by Cole Hoban.
Fresh 24 for the Warriors. Charge on offensive foul on Waterloo. They turn the ball right over.
Yeah, it was termed an illegal screen. He did move while setting it. I'm not sure about the call, although if you notice that it's going to lead to a layup or something, then perhaps you have to call it if, in fact, it was a moving screen at all.
Manigan bringing the ball up. Off to Phillip Scrub. Back to Manigan, who's never afraid to shoot or drive to the hoop, that's for sure. Willie Manigan, colorful player. Thomas Scrub in the game now. We have the ultimate nightmare. Both Scrub brothers are in. Shot clock winding down. Churchill manages to get the shot off and his own rebound. Makes his own rebound. Nice hustle. We talked about Kevin Churchill. That's the Kevin Churchill of 2011.
Well, and when he opened with the Ravens, he was not able to rebound.
Oh! Willie Manigan with one of his patented... What do you call that shot by Willie Manigan?
Well, a dipsy doodle or something, but...
There's an old-fashioned basketball game called Horse, where you had to duplicate the other guy's shot. You'd never want to play Horse with Willie Manigan.
You know, there's not a lot of players who are as good as Willie Manigan at converting that level of speed and quickness and yet releasing the ball properly at the end of it. He's still moving north-south so fast, faster than anyone, and yet the ball gently rolls into the rim instead of hard against the board.
Thomas Scrub into Kevin Churchill. Churchill drives to the basket. And again, Churchill is just, that was a good shot by Kevin Churchill.
You can see though, Waterloo is electing not to double down in the post. They're gonna see if the Churchill matchup is going to hurt them.
I would say based on the way Kevin Churchill has played this year, that it will hurt them.
I agree, and that take looked very confident, so if that continues, he will score.
Thomas Scrub bringing up the ball here. You know something, it's an absolute nightmare when they're both in the game together. Willie Manigan with the three. 21-3. We mentioned early on that Waterloo came into this game 4-2. Pretty good record.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, they're really fighting hard. I don't think this lead is an indication of just...
What do you mean by fighting hard?
Well, I mean, their game plan was to keep the pace. They're continuing with their game plan. They're running on offense like you wouldn't believe. They're attempting to defend. This is a real good start by the Ravens team because I don't actually believe that Waterloo is playing as poorly as what the score may indicate.
So is the matter of the Ravens are playing this well? Manigat misses. Justin Shaver now in for the Ravens. Two forty left in the first quarter. Waterloo's number four. Wayne Bridge misses the three. Ravens pick up the rebound. Manigat. Back to Thomas Scrub. Scrub driving to the hoop. And did he turn it over or draw the foul?
You know, it certainly is nice to see Justin Shaver getting an early look. He's been practicing quite well. In talking to Coach Smart, he's been starting to understand the rotations defensively a lot better. And his hustle and aggressiveness, and he certainly has talent, but it is nice to see him get an early look in the first quarter.
Thomas Scrub, another player tremendously improved this year.
Absolutely, and he's certainly comes from a family of basketball players, which is obvious. His talent was obvious from the beginning, not quite as polished as his brother, but has developed his game adequately as the older sibling, and probably a bit of sibling rivalry. When he saw his younger brother getting those minutes, he really stepped up his development.
Right with the three-point shot for Waterloo, misses. Churchill gets the rebound off to Thomas Scrub, off to Willie Manigat. Manigat bringing the ball up court. Top of the arc, Manigat under. Oh, what a nice pass. Willie Manigat, the number 22 Cole Hogan. Beautiful pass.
Absolutely, and it actually came off an error. Cole Hoban running up the wrong wing and trying to fix himself, and he ends up with a backdoor layup.
Nice three-point basket by Waterloo's number 8, Perdikick. Thomas Scrub underneath to Justin Shaver. Shaver goes up top there. He doesn't make the basket, but a freshman shows that in the not-too-distant future, Justin Shaver will be a physical presence.
Absolutely. And the other thing that you see that teams work on all the time is the post ceiling in transition. It's not natural, it's not an easy thing to do to seal properly at this pace of play. And yet the Carleton posts do it as well as anybody can.
Shaver misses the first of two fouls. 23-6 now for the Ravens. Minute 37 seconds left in the first quarter. Makes a second one, 24-6. Cross down, it's Ottawa U, 36-27 over Laurier, who's ranked 8th in the country.
Again, the Ravens defense rotating properly. They're in every situation jumping to the basketball, really making it tough on the Waterloo Warriors right now.
Manigat setting it up to Churchill. Churchill taking a three now. That's not giving Churchill a shot.
No, but the fact that he took it without hesitation bodes well for him because he is playing confidently.
Elliot Thompson with the rebound. Less than a minute to go in the quarter. Dan Penner getting ready to check in for the Ravens. Justin Shaver driving to the hoop underneath to Churchill. Churchill with the reverse layup. Gotta say that Kevin Churchill impressing me more and more every day.
Yeah, he certainly has impressed tonight.
Working hard. Let me ask you a question. Can Kevin Churchill push Kyle Smenziak out of the starting lineup?
Well, you know, Kyle has improved his offense a bit, but the one thing about Kyle is that he's such a solid defender. He defends in the post extremely well, and his rebounding ability is incredible because of his strength. I don't know that we'll see that happen, though it's getting closer and closer all the time.
Churchill with the ball underneath. Churchill, as we say, it gets closer. Another basket to Kevin Churchill. And you know something? It's hard taking a guy out of the starting lineup who started for 2 years.
Yeah, and you know, there's another thing too. You don't overcoach a team that is successful. You know, don't fix what ain't broke.
What a first quarter for the Ravens. 28-6, any thoughts?
Well, Waterloo is shell-shocked. As a coaching staff, it's difficult to talk about adjustments because you just hope that Carleton stops draining those shots and stops running that successfully.
We'll take a quick break. The score, Carleton University 28, Waterloo 6. You're watching Ravens basketball on the Streaming Sports Network. Welcome back to the Ravens Nest. Score heading into the second quarter. Not a lot to say, Bill Arden, although we're trying, given this is a basketball broadcast and we're supposed to be talking, and camera dude would beat us up if we didn't talk. But 28-6, not a lot more to say.
No, I think if you're Waterloo, you want to tighten up your fundamentals in terms of getting to the shoulder on screens. Really come off screens tight so that you force the Ravens to have to play impeccable defense. And you have to keep attacking with confidence.
Dan Penner now in for the Ravens. There's a great cliche about a 28-6 score in the word Waterloo, but Willie Mannigan, another great Mannigan basket. That's one of the hardest names I've had to pronounce, Willie Mannigan. First time I did games, Eddie Pomacolo was emailing me from Bishop's, imploring me to get the name right, knowing, of course, when Eddie was at Dawson, I had a hard time getting his name right. Wright with the three-point shot. That was a good three-point shot by Mr. Wright. He was open.
I've been impressed with Waterloo's transition after a score. That's a very coached and practiced thing. If you're able to actually, after the other team scores, get the ball in and up as fast as they do, that's something they've worked on greatly.
I'll get the stats at halftime, but I'll bet you the Ravens are shooting well over 60%.
Well, and a lot of them are layups, so you certainly would expect a high shooting percentage.
But you can't do much if the other team is playing to their level of capability.
No, and sometimes changing the pace of play can do it because you can force more outside shots than the layups that they're getting.
Shot clock winding down. Wright takes a three-point and does hit the rim, which meant it wasn't a time count violation. Holman off to Thompson. Thompson underneath, misses, gets his own rebound, misses. Looks like Churchill will head to the foul line for two shots.
Well, those are two layups that should have gone in, just to prove my point wrong. But when you are getting shots in close, obviously your shooting percentage is going to be a decent one.
Churchill gets ready for the first of two foul shots, misses.
It's one of the things that you have to, as a veteran, you have to understand that despite the pace of the game, which has been incredible, when you're on the free throw line, the pace has to slow down. I thought he took that shot a little quick.
Churchill makes the second one. He'll take a breather. Tyson Hinds coming back in. Waterloo bringing the ball up. Turns the ball over. Cole Holman, he'll drive to the basket. Holds up. Talk to me about that drive. Although Phillips scored, he gets the rebound. Why didn't Cole Holman finish that?
Well, I think he was intimidated by the block, which you can't be. He should have shot the first one rather than doing the spin.
Now, Cole Holman, second team All-Canadian last year, intimidated?
Well, I certainly don't believe he's actually intimidated. What I mean by that is concerned with a block.
I agree with you, and arguably the most intimidating player in University basketball in Canada.
Actually, I agree with that. I certainly, even as an all-star, would not want to have to go up against Cole Hoban's defense.
We have a timeout on the basketball court. We have a score. Carleton University 33, Waterloo 6, 7:15 left in the first half. Phil, I look at the Carleton Ravens preseason and the games they played against the American schools, and we did a couple games on the streaming sports network. But I look at the five guys on Carleton, Tyson Hinds, Phillips Grubb, arguably the two best players in university basketball in Canada.
Well, I actually have to agree. I think that Tyson can score in any way, and although Phillip isn't a post-up player, he scores in many ways as well. Defensively, they're always around the basketball. They can play at an up-tempo pace. They can slow it down.
All right, so Carleton has the best two players. We're not anywhere in Canada, and I'll argue that Cole Holman would be among the top five. So one team has three of the top five guys in Canada.
Well, I think that Cole Holman is the number one defensive guard in the country. I think that Whether or not that puts him into the top five as overall players, I'm not sure. But with that said, obviously their roster, which won the national championship last year and returned for another year, is great. We could also talk about sixth man category. Willie Maniget would be a starter on any basketball team in Canada.
So would Kevin Churchill. Tyson Hinds off to Thompson, off to Phillips Scrub. Scrub at the top of the key. Scrub passes back out to Thompson. Thompson off to Cole Hoban, underneath to Dan Penner. Penner in the game. Little dishes off, but a little travel to Dan. But a nice pass nonetheless.
Yeah, and it's an interesting choice. The Waterloo Warriors are deciding that the post game is going to be left one-on-one and that they're going to continue to deny the Ravens' traditional kick out to the perimeter. And so you'll see a lot more interior passing rather than kickouts for three-point shots.
So, right, so they're trying to take away the three-point shot from the Ravens.
Yeah.
Waterloo's number 10, McIntyre. Was that a three-point basket that was good?
I believe so. Four-point play coming up.
Now, the rare, and I mean rare, four-point play.
And it should be rare. You don't foul an airborne shooter. You certainly don't foul an airborne three-point shooter.
And you don't foul Cam McIntyre, who makes a four-point shot for Waterloo. So Waterloo almost doubled their entire point total in one Cam McIntyre four-point play. Tyson Hinds underneath to Dan Penner. Penner! With the slam-a-jamma! I have to ask those questions. Dave Smart doesn't like Thompson, does he?
Not true. Dave Smart doesn't like showboating, and he certainly doesn't like anything that isn't fundamental. So if you ask, will Dan Penner be talked about for that dunk? Absolutely not. All the Ravens, and I coached with Dave for a long time, have freedom to do it, but they had better pull it off.
Okay, because we had a game here a couple weeks ago, and GM Bucard, who hasn't played yet, missed on a dunk, on a showboat dunk. Is that why young Bucard is still on the bench?
What Dave Smart will do is he will call you on any selfish act because it's a team sport. So if he if his interpretation of it is that whatever it was, whether we're talking about a dunk, whether about rolling your eyes at the official, if he interprets it as a selfish act, you will hear about it and you will pay for that.
Well, I mean, the Ravens have a 35-10 lead, and GM Bucard again hasn't. He's still wearing his sweat, though.
Well, I'm certain that there's other factors there involved as well. Dave Smart doesn't say that a game's going to end up as a blowout just because it's a blowout early. So he's still doing his normal rotation as if this game were a one-point game.
Now, not every player manages to stick to the Ravens. Benjamin Felix would have been the Ravens' almost first seven-footer. He's not playing for the team this year.
It absolutely is not for everybody. The pace and commitment to practice that is needed, the locker room pressure by all the teammates who have won before and expect winning in practice, it's not for everyone, but it is for people who are willing to commit fully to winning.
What do you mean in it? Locker room pressure. Philip Scrub makes the basket 37-10. What about locker room pressure?
There's a culture in the locker room that says that we're a team. If you want to complain about the coaching, you don't do it there. You go like a man and you talk to the coach. If you want to talk like someone who is selfish, it ain't going to fly in that locker room, so you're going to hear about it from your teammates. And that's what's helped establish the winning culture. So it is not for everybody. If you come in with an excuse-oriented personality and you try to pull those excuses off in the locker room after practice, you will hear about it.
Philip Scrub kicks it out to Thomas Scrub. Thomas Scrub, a little brotherly love there. Thomas Scrub hits a three. Waterloo. Ravens up 40-12 now. Thomas Scrub picks up the rebound. peels off the Phillips scrub, back out to Thomas scrub. I think the bros are getting together here.
And I think the pace, even though Waterloo wants to run, is wearing them down. And you're seeing it with a lack of rebounding at both ends. They look tired having to take an all-star off the floor for a rest. This pace and the pressure is getting to them now.
Waterloo inbounds the ball. Wayne Bridge. Tied up by, he sort of fell on the basketball court, Wayne Bridge from Waterloo. And Willie Manigat held on the ball, on the turnover ball goes to the Ravens.
You know, you mentioned about the substitutions. The other thing you don't want to do is establish with your team that the opponent isn't worthy of our best players that early. That's a dangerous thing to do. It can change the momentum completely. The other thing is, if you're a star player for the Carleton Ravens and you keep blowing out teams, and that causes you to be benched for the sake of a lesser player playing, that's not good reinforcement for your efforts. So if the Carleton starters have earned this lead early, still let them get their minutes.
And number 15 of Waterloo, Zach Angeletti, makes it 42-15. Ravens up 42-15, 3:21 left in the first half.
And there you see the standard still being upheld.
Scrub with the three, 45-15.
I think we may see a substitution for Kyle Spenziak, who missed a rotation, allowing the last three-point shot by Waterloo.
Well, we talked about Guillaume Boucard. Looks like young Boucard is coming in the game. Now, is Ryan Augustine still with the team? I don't see him on the bench.
Yeah, I haven't seen him, and I don't know the story behind it, actually. So
I have to ask Coach Smart and get that for our viewers tomorrow night. He was one of Toronto's better high school players. Did play in the preseason. Did play in the House Loudon.
You know, even for Carleton standards, the pace of the running offensively has been impressive tonight.
Going down again.
We're used to seeing it in bunches where they run and get out and run, but this has been consistently up-tempo.
It's one big bunch.
It's unbelievable.
47-15 now. Number 9, Cam McIntyre. You mentioned McIntyre, and while nobody from Waterloo is doing that well, McIntyre still shows a lot of ability as a basketball player.
Yeah, he is impressive, but he was willing to pass after setting the screen previously, and then he had a little...
Dan Penner, a big man, goes outside and hits a 3, 50-17 now.
McIntyre had a little rest and was told by his coach, you need to score for us. When you set the screen and pop, hit the shot.
Justin Shaver forces a turnover for the Ravens. So I think we have all the starters are on the bench. Nope, Cole Hovind is still in. Willie Manigat, who we agree can start anywhere in the country, off to Dan. Makes another three-point shot, Penner.
Well, Carleton for years has been able to set the ball screen with a post player and have the post player roll to the perimeter. A post player should roll to the basket after setting ball screen. Not at Carleton, especially not when you can knock down the three ball like that.
Wright makes a three-point shot for Waterloo, 53-20. Manigat on the outside of the arc, never afraid to drive, and that's what Manigat does. Justin Shaver gets the rebound, doesn't make it. Nice job of rebounding, but no basket. A minute to go in the first half, 53-20. And Waterloo turns it over to the Ravens.
I have been very impressive with Dan Fanner's game tonight. I know he's knocked down two threes, but that's not the only reason. He's active defensively. He's active on the boards. It's nice to see.
Guillaume Bucard with the ball on the outside. Off to Penner. Penner off to Manigat. Manigat takes a three. Makes a three. 56-20. .41-38 at halftime. Ottawa U ahead of Laurier. That's a close game over at Mont Petit Hall. Manigat picks up a steal. Drives to Dan Penner. And Penner draws a foul.
Well, this game is definitely at a pace that Carleton is loving. They're hungry on defense, holding their team to a low shooting, the opponent to a low shooting percentage, and still getting out and filling those lanes. Not showing any signs of letting up.
9.1 seconds left. Penner with the first of two foul shots. Misses.
Again, I see them being too excited by the pace to slow down for the foul shot. That's a little better.
And he makes the second foul shot. Slowing it down. 58-20. Or 57-20. McIntyre misses a three, and the score at the half, Carleton University 57, Waterloo 20. Any quick thoughts before we take a break?
Well, I know that the game plan for Waterloo was to run, but I would try to slow this game down a little bit see if you can run quarter court sets against this Ravens team, who are applying pressure and finishing with layups after that pressure.
We'll take a break here at the Ravens Nest to score. Carleton University 57, Waterloo 20. You're watching Ravens basketball on the Streaming Sports Network.
the Ravens shooting as you...
Welcome back to the Ravens Nest. The score is 57-20. Bill, let's get some statistics data.
Well, for the Ravens, certainly as you mentioned, their shooting was incredible. 22 of 40 overall, 7 from 12 from the arc. Their free throw shooting, believe it or not, was actually uncharacteristically low, only shooting 50%, 6 for 12. With that said, the torrid pace, I mean, 40 shots in the half and hitting 22 of them, that is tough to defend.
Needless to say, 57 of 23 is... McIntyre hit a three at for Waterloo. And taking him powers with a three.
And again, we have a post setting a ball screen out on the wing and deciding to roll perimeter, knocking down the three. Very tough to defend.
Cam McIntyre with another two. He's got 5 points this half already for Waterloo. Tyson Hinds. Off to Phillip Scrub. Scrub drives. Oh, what if he's going to kick it back out?
Yeah, that might have been an ill-advised shot. Carlton had space properly, so you would think the kick out was coming, but nonetheless, it's good aggressiveness.
Phillip Scrub gets it off to Smentiak, off to Thompson. Tyson hits the top of the arc. He falls short. Smentiak draws a foul.
Carlton coach Dave Smart wants Kyle Smentiak to be a bit more of an offensive threat. Not, I don't think, happy with his spacing offensively. And I think what we'll see is Kevin Churchill, who's shown that he's willing to be a scorer, coming in for him in the early going.
And we did mention earlier, what about Smentiak? What about Kevin Churchill becoming a potential...
Well, again, I mean, Dave Smart wins championships based on quarter-court defense, and until he's equal in that regard, his offensive prowess will not overshadow Kyle's defensive ability.
Wright misses the layup. Smentiak gets the rebound. Thompson takes the three. Ravens aren't sharp in the first 2 minutes.
Well, I mean, they nailed the three off the ball screen, and they've managed, despite having a significant lead, to decide to keep the pace up. So there are encouraging signs for Coach Smart. I will agree, though, they don't look as sharp as they did. But how could you continue that pace?
Kevin Churchill had how many points? 7 points for the Ravens. Thought he had more than 7 points. Out of bounds, the last touch by the Ravens. 61-25, 8:01 left in the third quarter. We're very early.
Well, remember that a lot of the points were scored in transition, and so they were guard points for Phillip Scrub and Willie Manigat, leading to their 12 points apiece, leading all Ravens scores.
Basket scored by number 25, Brandon Smith.
Brandon Smith, he makes a basket for Waterloo just as the shot clock was about to expire. Pulling Manigat now in the game. Manigat pulls up, takes a short jumper, 63-27. Elliot Thompson picks up a steal. Justin Shaver getting ready to come back in very early, as you pointed out, Eric.
Well, Coach Smart was lamenting the fact that the Ravens' full court pressure was not placed after the score, last score, and he was wondering why not.
Manigat misses the three. Waterloo picks up the rebound. Thompson with the rebound, gives it off to Willie Manigat. Manigat coming up court, top of the arc, drives to the basket, turns it over, but not get a bounce by Waterloo. Shaver and Thomas Scrub back in for the Ravens. Manigat off the Thomas scrub. Scrub. Willie Hines. Hines gets the rebound. Willie Hines. Gotta forgive me. How many people know who Willie Hines is? Probably, would it be me and you?
You know, Tyson, he just spaces so well. That's been a real advancement in his game from the high school game. He came in as a natural scorer. He understood how his body works, and he was always wiry like that as a scorer in high school, but he didn't necessarily space on penetration as well as he does now. And he just gets to the right area, the guards find him, and he's so tough to defend as a result.
Does Tyson do more with his talent as a basketball player than most players you've seen?
He does more with his body than other players.
He is
pretty gifted athlete. Maybe doesn't get as much credit for it because his stance is a bit awkward. But the truth is, he's a very good athlete. And the other thing is, he knows his body and has played both post and guard all his life. So he's really developed a lot of those skills, both with his back to the basket and from the perimeter.
Truth be told, that the late Pat O'Brien and I did our best to recruit Willie Hines, Tyson's father, probably. I guess a Rhodes Scholar and McGill look a little more impressive than Carleton.
And still an impressive-looking player. I had the pleasure of watching him play with his son in the alumni weekend, and it was a lot of fun.
Willie Manigat makes a three. We would have rather had Willie play his basketball at Carleton. We had two fouls along the clutch. We got the son, and that's pretty good here at Carleton. Funny how you remember trying to recruit. And I met Willie a couple of years ago when Tyson was just playing his last year of high school. He didn't remember me, and I said, he remembered being a kid. But he made the right choice for him in going to McGill. But you have to wonder how he felt about his son coming to Carleton.
Well, I think he's pretty happy now, and the development that Tyson has had here at Carleton has helped him improve his chances for our national team and is in his future. And I really do believe he's got a bright future ahead for international basketball as well.
Baseline to baseline. Willie Manigat with the hoop, 70-27. .456 left in the third quarter at the Raven's Nest. Cross town, it's 47-44 for Ottawa U over Laurier. Willie Manning with a nice pass to Dan Penner, who draws a foul.
Again, the Ravens guards are getting deep in transition. The Ravens have not had to set up their traditional break offense very often tonight. The guards in transition are getting deep, drawing defense, and then making interior passes. Very rarely a kick out. As I said, part of the Waterloo game plan was to defend the wings. And so they're making interior passes to the post. And Dan is on his game tonight.
Dan Penner makes the first of two foul shots, 71-27. And I apologize again for coughing. 72-27. I get some pops here for tomorrow night.
And another great shift for Willie Manigat.
Waterloo's number 15, Zach Angeli, hits a 3, 72-30. Dan Penner takes a three, falls short. Guillaume Boucard picks up the rebound. Nice hustle by Boucard there. Justin Shaver.
Well, that's actually a decent attack. Coach Smart says that if you catch it in the post, if they don't double down, you have to score. If you kick it out, it's going to lead to a turnover. You can't pass up one-on-one situations in the low post.
Shaver taking the first of two foul shots. 73 now to 30. Makes it. And makes a second. Now, what other hasn't called the timeout? I guess there's no. Is there a point in calling the timeout?
At this point, you call timeouts to teach specific things. So if a situation occurs where a coach says, you know, that's one of our tendencies that I hate, I really want to address it just after it happened, then he'll call a timeout to teach.
Warriors with the ball. Ball short. And number 13 to Waterloo. Justin Johnson rebounded, but didn't quite pick up the rebound because he fouled Elliot Thompson.
Yeah, push off from behind, which was a fairly obvious call. Even in a blowout, you want those ones called. I don't need everything called at this point in the game, obviously. But you do need those ones called because the game can get a little bit unsafe if the out-of-position push fouls aren't addressed.
Favor. Makes the first of two foul shots. And the second. To 30 now. 3:30 left in the third quarter. Cross town, it's now 52-46. Ottawa U over Laurier. Ben Penner gets the rebound off to Philip Scrub. Scrub heads up court. Off to Guillaume Boucard. Guillaume Boucard. Was that a good shot by Guillaume Boucard?
Well, I mean, he's certainly athletic, and he's been told to attack because that's one of his...
We got it now. Boucard made a three-point shot. But I want to ask you, was there a little too much Strowman in that shot?
I think that he's playing confidently, and he has to attack because he's been told that if he's out there, he's got to make hay. He's got to do his thing. And his thing is athletic attacks.
Elliot Thompson off to Philip Scrub. Scrub at the left side of the arc. Underneath to Dan Penner. Penner with the one-handed shot, falls short, but gets the rebound off to Thompson. Off to Scrub. Scrub underneath back to Dan Penner, and Penner draws the foul. It's a nice team basketball.
It really is, and as I said, because of the game plan by Waterloo, there's been an amazing amount of interior passes available. Of course, you need your posts to seal properly, and Dan is doing it as well as I've seen him do it in his entire career right now.
As the second person to the line shooting four, your Carleton Ravens, number 45, Dan Penner.
Penner makes a first of two foul shots. to 30. 81-31 now. 2:10 left in the third quarter. Waterloo on the outside.
As I mentioned, it certainly has been a tough night for Cam McIntyre. Nothing easy.
McIntyre at the force that shot, but did get it off before the buzzer went for the, which would have been the 24-second clock and a shot violation.
No need. No need for that hold. Coach Smart wondering why Kyle Smetsiak chose to do that and not let the team defense take care of that screen.
Waterloo basket number 25, Brendan Smith, 81-32 now for the Ravens. Minute 26 left in the third quarter. Penner, Maniget driving, kicks it out to Elliot Thompson. Thompson, Dan Penner, Dipsy Doodles, off the rim. Waterloo picks up the rebound. Waterloo bringing the ball up fourth. Right, passes off. Three-point basket, Andrew Melville.
Well, all stems from the dribble with the dominant hand from the offside. The Ravens defense caught off guard. Because of that, the other wing is supposed to be forced to the baseline, and it didn't happen on that play.
Now talk about the pace of the basketball game. The Ottawa U game started at least 10 minutes before this game, and we're at the end of the third quarter, and we're at the end of the third quarter. So because there have been so few whistles here, this game's been played at a very good pace.
Well, absolutely, and there haven't been any opportunity for whistles because it's been layups in transition so often.
I was believing we were going to get the final score in the Ottawa U game. 60-54 for the Gigi. So that still remains a close game. Foul.
I believe it will be called on the floor. So it'll be the bonus situation. Coach Kieswater thinking that there should have been continuation allowing for the score.
Number 20, Mike Wright, makes the first of two foul shots. 83-36.
He's certainly been a bright spot, in my opinion. The second-year guard out of Burlington, Ontario, number 20, Mike Wright. I think he's been had a great game tonight, despite this lopsided score.
Nice pass up court. Maniget to Thompson, although Thompson missed. Maniget has the rebound. And the Ravens will take one shot here. Clock winding down underneath to Shaver, and Shaver draws a foul.
You know, that again, that was so well executed. You can see there's 2.6 seconds left, not really enough time for a quality shot by the opponent, and yet you ended up with a quality shot opportunity down here. That is incredible end of clock execution by the Ravens.
Justin Shaver makes the first of two foul shots. 84-37. 85-37. That shot was a great shot, but it didn't count. That's too bad. Well, it's not too bad if you're a Ravens fan. Anyway, the score at the end of the third quarter. Carleton University 85. Waterloo 37. We'll take a quick break. You're watching Ravens basketball on the Streaming Sports Network. Welcome back to the Raven's Nest. We'll give you some quick out-of-town scores. Western beat Queens 85-64. Cape Breton pounded St. Mary's 106-84 at halftime. Brock ahead of Ryerson beating Brock 36-26. And over at Montpetit Hall, start of the fourth quarter, 60-59. Close ball game. Ottawa, you holding on to a one-point lead. And here at the Ravens Nest, Carleton University Ravens 85, Waterloo 37.
Yeah, I mean, there's not a lot of doubt in the outcome of this one here tonight. Certainly there's doubt over at Ottawa U, and that'll be an interesting fourth quarter over there. Here, you just want to keep executing so that you don't go backwards, slide backwards, and you do want to get some time for some other guys.